Shalom, everyone. Today we're going to talk about two very critical concepts that are discussed throughout the last couple of weeks' Torah portions and are going to be continued to be discussed as we go through the next bunch of Torah portions. As a matter of fact, it's probably one of the most key and comprehensive underlying themes of the entirety of the scriptures. And it's the concept of Tahor and Tamei. Tahor being clean and Tamei being unclean. And we're going to talk more about these terms and define them in a few minutes, but I've entitled this teaching, Tahor and Tamei, What State Are You In? And we're going to get into this in a lot of detail, because I think that this will be, in a large sense, one of the most profound teachings that will change the way you perceive, or at least I'm hoping that in a sense it will change the way you perceive a lot of what you've been studying and a lot of what you've been doing and a lot of how you've been applying things. Let's define the terms. Over the past few Torah portions, we've touched on a vital concept, and that's the concept of being clean or unclean, tahor or tamei. This week, we're going to take a closer look at this concept and seek a fuller understanding of its meaning and application. Let's begin by redefining the terms. To be tahor is to be clean, pure, untainted in a physical, chemical, ceremonial, or moral sense. To be tamei is to be unclean, impure, or defiled in a physical, chemical, ceremonial, or moral sense. Being tamei is not a physical condition. It is a state declared upon a person who came into contact with sin or death. That's the way we apply it in the scriptures. For example, from the previous week's teaching on Leviticus chapter 11, the kashrut laws, you would come to understand that eating of something that is not food would be coming into contact with sin, and the touching of a dead animal or a carcass would be to come into contact with death. And both of these things are examples of things that would lead a person to be declared tamei, or unclean. Now, once a person was declared tamei, he was prohibited from entering the Mishkan, the tabernacle, the temple, for a set period of time. Until the process set forth by Yahweh for the changing of one's state back to tahor was completed. So this is a state that you were in. You were either in the state of tahor or the state of tamei. Now this could take anywhere from 1 day to several months, depending on what it was and how the prescribed protocols in Torah were to go through a cleansing process to restore you back to the state of tahor. Now, by declaring a person tamei, Yahweh was in a sense saying, you are in a state where you are have either sinned yourself or have come into contact with death. I want you to know that my kingdom is totally separate from that realm. So I must prohibit you from coming into my house, the Mishkan, the temple, where you would be approaching my innermost chambers. Understand that these laws that were instituted on Tamei and Tahor were for our protection. The Almighty cannot come into contact with anything that is sin or death. And so if we are in a state where we've come into contact with either one of those and have not gone through the cleansing processes, to prevent himself from coming into contact with sin or death, that he would have to kill us, basically, if we were trying to enter into the tabernacle. So these laws are safety laws for our benefit, because he would not have any choice but to do what was necessary to prevent his coming into contact with sin or death. Now, this is why, by the way, we don't see the Father showing up here until there's a new heaven and a new earth in Revelation 21, and sin and death have been thrown into the lake of fire, and there is no more sin and there is no more death. It's only at that point that the Father can come and dwell amongst us, because he cannot come into contact with sin or death. Now, there are only two states you can be in regard to coming into the Mishkan, the temple, and coming into the presence of the Almighty. If you are Tahor, you can enter. If you are Tamei, you cannot. Now, I believe Yahweh instituted this process to teach his people a foundational spiritual reality. Life does not mix with death, sin does not mix with righteousness, and the sacred does not mix with the profane. If we could truly embrace this, we would be so much further along in the process. Life does not mix with death, sin does not mix with righteousness, and the sacred does not mix with the profane. And unfortunately, what we see out there in mainstream religion, specifically mainstream Christianity, mainstream Judaism, is we see a lot of mixing that which is of sin with righteousness or sacred with profane. We see a lot of mixing going on. That's how we find ourselves in the year 2011 with people keeping Sunday instead of Saturday. We find that we have people who are, you know, keeping Easter instead of Passover, who are doing Christmas. These are things that are mixing. They're mixing the sacred with the profane. And then they're putting a good spin on it and saying, well, no, it's actually, we're taking the profane and we're making it sacred. Now, I don't believe that that really works, and I think we're going to find that out very clearly as we go through this teaching, that that doesn't work. Now, there are only two kingdoms. The kingdom of this world, which is of sin, death, and darkness, with Hasatan, the adversary, as its king. And there's the kingdom of Elohim, which is of righteousness, life, and light, with the Father its king, and Yeshua sitting at his right hand, our soon-coming King of Kings. There is no third kingdom. There is no middle ground. Do not be deceived. Even self-sovereignty is really a part of the kingdom of this world, Hasatan's kingdom. The kingdom of this world can and often has tried to imitate and portray itself as being the kingdom of Elohim. We have that problem also with the self-sovereignty, where we take it upon ourselves to decide what's right and wrong. And we're going to see that that's the same problem that the deceiver tried to tempt Adam and Chava with. Now, if we keep in mind, and this is important, if we keep in mind that something is either Tahor or Tamei, we will be able to discern that when something consists of sin and or death, it is not of the kingdom of Elohim, no matter how much it may claim to or seem to be. Again, if something consists of sin and or death, it is not of the kingdom of Elohim, no matter how much it may claim or seem to be. Now, we are all probably able to figure out what death is, so let's define what sin is. In 1 John and 1 Yochanan chapter 3 and verse 1, let's turn there. 1 Yochanan, 1 John chapter 3 and verse 1. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of Elohim. Amen and amen. For this reason the world does not know us, because it did not know him. Beloved ones, now we are children of Elohim, and it has not yet been revealed what we shall be, but we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And everyone having this expectation in him cleanses himself as he is clean. Everyone doing sin also does lawlessness, and sin is, by definition, lawlessness. That's verse 4. Now, in verse 5, it says, and you know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him there is no sin. Everyone staying in him does not sin. Everyone sinning has neither seen him nor known him. Little children, let no one lead you astray. The one doing righteousness is righteous, even as he, Yeshua, is righteous. The one doing sin is of the devil, because the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of Elohim was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. Now, Does this not completely fit into what I've been saying? There are two kingdoms, one with Elohim at the head, one with Hasatan at the head, one of sin, one of righteousness, one of Torah observance, one of lawlessness, because that's where it talks about the law. Everyone doing sin, verse 4, also does lawlessness or Torahlessness, because sin is Torahlessness, the breaking of the Torah, the teachings and instructions of the Almighty. So Yochanan is helping us to understand what sin is. Now remember, sin keeps you out of the state you need to be in to be drawing near unto Elohim. It makes you Tamei. And when you're in a state of Tamei, you are prevented from drawing near the Almighty. In 1 John chapter 2, let's go back a chapter and look at verse 1. It says, my little children, I write this to you so that you do not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an intercessor with the Father, Yeshua Messiah, a righteous one. And he himself is an atoning offering for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for all the world. And by this verse 3, we know that we know him if we guard his commands. The one who says, I know him, and does not guard his commands, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever guards his word, truly the love of Elohim has been perfected in him. By this we know that we are in him. Verse 6, the one who says he stays in him ought himself also to walk even as he walked. Wow, there's a lot in that section. I love that section. Now, if we look at chapter 3 again in verse 1, it said, see what love the Father has given us, that we should be called the children of Elohim. For this reason, the world does not know us because it did not know him. So there's a lot of the word know in there. The world doesn't know us because it doesn't know him. Previous chapter defined that those who say they know him and keep not his commands are liars and the truth is not in them. And I think it's time that, I don't think I've done this on this teaching before, so I want to throw this in here. Let me give us a definition. In John 14 and in verse 6, let's define some of these terms from Scripture. John 14, let me turn there myself. I know there's a lot of teachers out there that like to just quote things and have it already printed out in their notes, but I like to take the time and have everyone take the time to turn the pages to the actual verse. In John 14 and verse 6, it says, Yeshua said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So now we're defining some terms. Yeshua is saying that he, by definition, is the truth. He's also saying he's the way and the life, but for this purpose of this teaching, we're going to focus on one of those three aspects, and the aspect is the word truth. Because we were just told that those who say they know him and keep not his commandments are liars and the truth is not in them. Well, what is the truth? Well, the truth is Yeshua, so Yeshua is not in them. By definition, Yeshua and truth are interchangeable. Now let's turn to Psalm 119 and verse 160. Tehillim, Psalm 119 and verse 160. Now for those of you who are familiar with studying the scriptures, if I had just told you to turn to verse 160, you would know that it would have to be in Psalm 119. It's the only place that has that many verses. Psalm 119 and verse 160 says, the entirety of your word is truth, and all your righteous right rulings are forever. So now we have a definition here that the entirety of the word of Yahweh is truth. In other words, the Torah, the teachings and instructions of Yahweh is truth. The entirety of the Torah is truth. Yeshua, John 14, 6, is truth. Here the word is actually the word word. That sounded interesting there, the word word. In Psalm 119, verse 160, the sum of your word is truth. In John chapter 1, we are told in verse 14 that the Word was made flesh and tabernacled amongst us. This is Yeshua. So what we've just created here was a wonderful word definition circular loop here, three-verse loop, that says Yeshua is the truth, the Word of Torah is the truth, the Word was made flesh, the Word that was made flesh is Yeshua. Therefore, we can interchange everywhere we see the name Yeshua, we can interchange truth and Torah. Everywhere we see the word truth, we can interchange Torah and Yeshua. And everywhere we see the word Torah, we can interchange truth and Yeshua. All three are the same thing. Yeshua is the walking, talking, living Torah. So when they say in John, when John says here, those who say they know him and keep not the Torah or his commands, well, obviously they're liars since he is the walking, talking Torah. So if you don't keep the Torah, then obviously you don't know him because he is the Torah. He's the Torah made flesh. He's the Word made flesh. And so, of course, if that were the case, then the truth, which is also the Torah, which is Yeshua, would not be in them. So I hope that helps clarify that in a lot more depth because these are really, really important points. I don't want to be called a liar. And John very clearly doesn't pull any punches here and says, the ones who say they know him and don't keep his commands are liars, and the truth is not in them, and that's not the kind of place I'd like to be. So if you're in that same spot and you don't want to be there either, we need to really spend a lot of time trying to understand the truth because we know also the verse says that you shall know the truth, and then the knowledge of that truth, or Torah and Yeshua, all three, will make you free, will set you free, as we understand and know what truth really is. And by definition, Torah, Yeshua are the truth. Now, let's continue. Beware Hasatan the deceiver. Remember, we were talking about two kingdoms here. But I want us to make an important note. Please note, however, that just because there are only two kingdoms doesn't mean that they have equal power or equal authority. There is nothing equal about them. There is no dualism in this universe. There is only Elohim, and he is all. He is its absolute sovereign. Hasatan wants us to believe, however, that his kingdom is not only equal to, but also greater than that of Elohim. We have many examples of this, unfortunately, in Scripture, but the good news is because we have it as examples, we know with confidence that this is what the enemy is trying to do. Adam and Chava had to deal with this in Genesis in Bereishit chapter 3 and in verse 5. What was it that the deceiver had basically offered them that caused all the trouble? He basically was trying to convince them that his kingdom was equal to, or self-sovereignty as a kingdom would be equal to, or greater than that of Yahweh, that of the Almighty. In Bereishit chapter 3 and verse 5, he says, the enemy's talking here, and he says, for Elohim knows that in the day that you eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that you eat of it, your eyes shall be open, and you shall be like him, knowing good and evil. See, he's trying to create an equal signs here. If you eat this fruit, you'll be equal to Elohim. What I say previously, there's nothing equal about these two kingdoms. There is no dualism. There is the false pretender kingdom of the enemy and the true and only kingdom of the Almighty. You know, Yeshua in the wilderness is given the same type of, conversation in a sense from the enemy as was given to Adam and Chava. In Matthew chapter 4, let's turn there, Matthew chapter 4 and in verse 8. And again, the devil took him up on a very high mountain. This is the devil taking Yeshua up on a high mountain. And he showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these I shall give you if you fall down and worship me. So what exactly is Hasatan saying here? He's saying, I have the power. I have the authority. I am equal to the Almighty. I can give you power and kingdoms. See, this is the temptation that he's thinking he's giving to Yeshua, which obviously wasn't a very tough temptation for him to just say, I don't think so. Because then Yeshua says, go, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship Yahweh your Elohim, and him alone you shall serve. And the devil left him. So this was the end of the battle. The last straw-ditch effort that the enemy had was to try to offer sovereignty, self-sovereignty, a choice to change kingdoms. And Yeshua said, I'm of the one and only true kingdom. I serve the Father. Now we can see by these examples, okay, that if we think about today's world and what's going on in the world, we can see examples of this mindset today. We see many in the churches running around trying to save everyone as if there is a contest between Yahweh and Hasatan. If this were true, an honest look at the world, I think would be, if we're being honest, we definitely would have to believe that Yahweh was losing and losing badly at that. See, there's no contest going on here. We don't have to go out there and quote-unquote save souls. The Father is going to take care of this exactly how he's always planned to take care of it, and he doesn't necessarily need you and me to run around trying to save everybody. It's being made to seem like when you listen to some of these Sunday preachers, how they brag about, last year we saved thousands of souls. As if there was a scoreboard and a contest going on here. Well, there is no contest. There's one true kingdom and one false kingdom, and the false kingdom only thinks it has power and authority, and the true kingdom has it all and is the only truth. So knowing that there are two kingdoms, my encouragement to you is to choose your citizenship wisely. It is very important to note that the kingdom of this world does exist and possesses a lot of power. It does exist, and it does possess a lot of power. It's power that is wielded relentlessly by its king, Hasatan, to control and influence its citizens and vie for our allegiance. You are a citizen of one kingdom or the other. There is no middle ground. Now, just because I say that it has power and lots of it doesn't mean that it's equal to, in any way, shape, or form, the kingdom of the Almighty. But it does power. It is powerful nonetheless. It has the power to deceive, if possible, the elect. We have that in Scripture. It has the power to lead you down the path that leads to the second death, from which there is no coming back. That's why I say to you, you are a citizen of one kingdom or the other, and there is no middle ground, so choose your citizenship wisely. Matthew 6 and in verse 24. Let's read there. Matthew 6:24. No one is able to serve two masters, for either he shall hate the one and love the other, or else he shall cleave to the one and despise the other. You are not able to serve Elohim and Mammon. So here again is a verse to back up what I was just saying. You are going to only be able to serve one. You can't serve two. You can only serve one. Which is why those who are out there serving the one hate us for serving the other. That is why we're persecuted. That's why we're not understood. That's why we have verses to say the world did not know him, and so therefore the world doesn't know us. What is him? He is the truth. He is Yeshua. He is the Torah. The world doesn't get it. We're supposed to get it. Romans chapter 6 and in verse 16. Romans chapter 6 and in verse 16. Do you not know that to whom you present yourselves servants for obedience, you are servants of the one whom you obey, whether of sin to death or of obedience to righteousness? But thanks to Elohim that you are servants of sin, that when you were servants of sin, yet you obeyed from the heart that form of teaching to which you were entrusted, and having been set free from sin, you became servants of righteousness. But notice in verse 16 again, do you not know that to whom you present yourself servants for obedience, you are servants of the one whom you obey, whether sin to death or obedience to righteousness? There are two kingdoms. One leaves you in a state of tahor, or cleanliness, where you can approach. The other leaves you in a state of unclean, tamei, where you cannot approach the Almighty. And so if you're finding yourself struggling in your approaching of the Almighty, you feel like your prayers are just hitting the ceiling, if you feel like you're disconnected, there may be a sin issue that needs to be rooted out. There may be something that has rendered you tamei that needs to be rooted out. We're going to talk about more about examining yourself in a little bit. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 19. Let's talk a little bit more about citizenship here. Ephesians chapter 2 and in verse 19. Remember, there's two kingdoms and you need to choose your citizenship wisely. Verse 19. So then you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the set apart ones, and members of the household of Elohim, having been built upon the foundation of the emissaries and prophets, Yeshua Messiah himself being chief cornerstone, in whom all the building, being joined together, grows into a set-apart dwelling place in Yahweh, in whom you also are being built together into a dwelling of the Elohim in the Spirit. Now, we're no longer strangers. We're no longer foreigners, but fellow citizens, if we choose to be. This doesn't happen by default. It doesn't happen because you made an altar call. It doesn't happen because you declared a name. It happens because you make a citizenship choice. Just like Ruth did. What did Ruth do? She was a Moabitess. Moabites were not on the well-liked list, according to Scripture. The Ammonites and the Moabites were not to come into the assembly unto the 10th generation. Yet Ruth is in the lineage of Messiah. And it's less than 10 generations. How could that be? Because we know in Ruth, it says that she said to Naomi, she said, your people will be my people, your Elohim, my Elohim, your ways, my ways. I'm going to follow along and change my citizenship. Praise Yahweh that when you change your citizenship, it matters not what you were before. Your sin is now taken away from you as far as the east is from the west. So it's a citizenship choice, and we always have to remember that. That's why there's so many verses that deal with circumcision versus the uncircumcised, the Jew or Greek, the male or female, all of that stuff. It's just trying to make the point that it doesn't matter how you were born or what you started out as. What matters is the citizenship decision that you make, which is evidenced by the walk that you walk. That's why we have Deuteronomy 8:2, where it says that Yahweh led them through the desert the 40 years to test them, to prove them, to see whether it was in their heart to keep the commandments or not. And that's what was important. Remember that whole verse is dealing with the mixed multitude that came out of Egypt. And by the time we got out of Egypt and you get to the promised land, we get to the Jordan 40 years later, we find that they're crossing all as Israelites, that those who had made the citizenship choice were now part of Israel. So this is all about citizenship.